All right, we're turning in our Bibles to Philippians chapter 3. We're going to be looking this morning at verses 17 through 21 as we complete this very powerful chapter, which, by the way, began with a condemnation. Now, that's different than a commendation. So a commendation means that you are approving of something that was that has been done. And a condemnation is something where you are disapproving of something that was done. And we read, or we have read and studied in verse 2 of Philippians chapter 3, that the people of the church of Philippi are to watch out for those dogs, those men who do evil, those mutilators of the flesh. And the focal point, really, you might say throughout the letter to the Philippians, but sincerely in chapter 3, the focal point is upon those who attempt to add things to the cross of Jesus Christ. That would say to you, yeah, great, you're a Christian, you believe in Christ, you believe in his resurrection. And perhaps as Peter said, if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Christ has risen from the dead, you are saved. So that's the pivotal point of salvation, okay? It's not just that Jesus lived, not that just that Jesus died. Scripture declares that there were two other men that died that afternoon, beyond also all the others, perhaps in thousands who died that day, but only one rose on the third day. And so our faith is pivoted upon the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And I've said this in previous Resurrection Sunday messages, that really the symbol of the Christian is not so much the cross, though Jesus tells us to carry, to bury, that bear the burden of the cross, crucifying our flesh daily, but really the proper symbol of Christianity is the empty grave. And you know, if you carry this tomb on your around your neck, someone ought to make those with in silver or gold or precious stones, whatever it is. But that's really what we as Christians, our heart is set upon the fact that Jesus did rise from the grave on the third day. We believe that in our hearts. We've confessed that with our mouths, particularly at water baptism. And thereby we are saved. That's what makes us Christians, okay? So when someone attempts to add to the cross, they say, great, all right, you're Christians, but you need to also observe, as it were, kosher laws, or they confuse, following all the commandments of Jesus, you know, with all the 613 Levitical laws, to say that really the New Testament's all right, but the Pentateuch, the Torah, is the most important portion of Scripture, because therein we get how to live as proper Christians before our God. And that's completely wrong. And Paul attacks those who would be otherwise known as Judaizers in his day. In other words, they are Christians, as it were, but also Christians who have attempted to improve upon the performance of Christ on the cross, the performance of Christ in the empty grave. And that's what's so cool about the grace of God, isn't it? The mercy of God. It's not, our salvation is not based on our performance. It's based on his performance. Amen? You turn this up, I didn't get much there. Come on. So these are Judaizers he is calling dogs. And really, in Scripture, that's a pretty low appraisal of who these men are, because they're confusing Christians, particularly Jewish Christians, who've been set free. Paul said to the churches of Galatia, it is for freedom that Christ has set you free, Galatians 5, verse 1. So do not be entangled, captivated through the obedience to the law once again. He furthermore says in chapter 3, you know, who has bewitched you? Those of you who have begun in the Spirit of God, now to complete it in the flesh. And you know, we're compelled oftentimes by things that are performance-based, right? Because you only win the prize if you're first. Well, it used to be that way anyways. Now everybody gets a prize. Everybody goes home with a trophy. Every Christian gets the same prize, to see him face to face, to finally be healed completely as we gain ground in heaven with our Lord. And by the way, I just want to mention this once again. I'm going to mention it later as well. Every Christian is guaranteed healing. All right? Healing either miraculously at the moment they are prayed for or anointed. Secondly, healing in process, which often occurs through doctors or whatever doctors may prescribe. And lastly, of course, every Christian is guaranteed complete, utter, and perfect healing when we leave the land of the living. We cross the Jordan into God's promised land. Jesus really, really offended by the way that the Pharisees and the scribes were acting in his day, because they had attempted to improve even on the 613 laws of the Torah. They had attempted to improve upon those things by becoming even more strict on things never even mentioned in Scripture. And Jesus said this in Matthew 15, verses 7 through 9. He said, "Hypocrites! Well did Isaiah prophesy about you, saying, 'These people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men.'" How many of you have been impacted, maybe even offended by the doctrines of men that cannot be found in Scripture, though they are often alluded to, or somebody uses Scripture to springboard into, this is what holiness looks like. This is what holiness looks like, and if you don't follow the edicts and the commandments of men, then you can't be holy. You certainly can't be holy, you know? Used to be chrome bumpers on a car. If you had chrome bumpers on your car, you couldn't possibly be holy. How many are not holy this morning because you got chrome on your bumpers? Well, you think, well, that's kind of silly. Oh, it gets sillier than that in some cases. We begin in verse 17 of Philippians chapter 3 with the subject, bitter or better. Bitter or better. Paul writes in Philippians 3, verse 17, "Brethren, join in following my example, and note those who so walk, as you have us." In other words, you have Epaphroditus, you have Timothy, you have me, you have us as a pattern. Did you know that God often includes prescriptions or patterns for the way to conduct our lives on this earth? And they are so typically completely different from the patterns that man attempts to confound us with. Did you know that God has a pattern for worship? Did you know that you would not dare enter the tabernacle of the living God unless you had followed certain prescribed patterns in order to even approach the tabernacle in the wilderness? You were not allowed to worship in your own way. You had to worship in God's prescribed pattern. And we've left that pattern so often. The pattern for our worship is often something that is so complacent, almost borderline bored, hoping that at some point worship will end, this whole day will end, and I can get back to my business. Worship in Hebraic patterns was one that you never sat. You stood with hands raised or flat on your face with hands before you. You had a reverence for God that began in the Psalms of Ascension from your very own home, from the threshold of your house as you traveled toward Jerusalem on the three solemn festivals of Israel. You followed the Psalms of Ascension as you worshiped in anticipation of coming even close to the house of the living God, knowing that as you stood in the courtyard of the Kotel, of the Temple Mound, there in that building before you, stood the temple of God, the throne of grace, his mercy seat. That is where God had chosen to meet and to dwell among people. Exodus 25 goes into length about that. People couldn't just run into the Holy of Holies. People are said to have died in approaching God outside of the pattern of his worship. He has patterns for loving. He has patterns for obedience. He has patterns for giving. Did you know that? He has patterns of response even when we are challenged. And that's what we're focusing on primarily this morning. A pattern for response. And the response oftentimes as we deal with the issues of today are either being bitter or better. I hope I can convince you to follow the pattern of response that would make you better in the things that challenge you this morning. Paul says, use me, use us as an example. I love how Paul, chained to a wall in a pit in Rome, says, use me as an example. Well, not a lot of people reading this from the city of Philippi would make the journey to Rome to gain ground in their faith in Christ by chaining themselves to the wall as well. But what was it that Paul was speaking about? He was speaking about his response to the things that had occurred in his life. And certainly what had occurred in his life were things that anybody, even in a cursory appraisal, would say, that's horrifying. I couldn't imagine being in that situation. And yet Paul made the very best of it. Why? Because he chose to be better, not bitter. Get that? He chose to be better, not bitter. How many of you would have chosen to be bitter? Maybe you're even bitter thinking about that could happen to you. What about choosing to be better? It was that very attitude that he reminds the church of Philippi that he had when he was chained into the cave in the city of Philippi. And a great earthquake blew open the doors. And the Roman sent the guard came rushing down to the gate and certainly thought that all the prisoners had escaped. And Paul, from deep within that cave, Lucy and I have been there, declared, we are all here. And he could hear them worshiping the living God. Is that bitter or is that better? Friends, we can think about what it means to be better like that and say or pass it off as simply, well, I mean, he was an apostle for crying out loud. He had that encounter with Christ on the off-ramp to Damascus, you know. I don't know that I've had that. So, you know, that's an apostle and I'm just maybe a disciple. Friends, we are all to have the mind of Christ. All to have the mind of Christ. Remember Philippians chapter 2, starting in verse 5 through 11? Have this mind in you that was also in Christ Jesus. What's that mind? Choosing to respond, understanding that God's intention is to make us better, not bitter. Can you imagine a God that wants you to become more bitter? But I can imagine a lot of people that would love to revel in your bitterness only to prove that Christ has made no difference in your life. No difference in your life because there is a root of bitterness in you that is all too obvious. Is there a root of bitterness in you that is obvious to some people in your realm of connection? Paul says, follow my example. By the way, Paul made a point of pointing out to other apostles when they were choosing to be bitter rather than better. A prime example of that is found in Galatians chapter 2, verses 11 through 14, when Paul confronted Peter and Barnabas on that very subject. Now, they were up in the city of Antioch. By the way, the city in the Mediterranean where they first began to call followers of Christ Christians. That's where you get the term, a Christian. I'm a Christian because that term was coined in the city of Antioch in those ancient days. And Peter was there among the Gentiles of Antioch. And he was supping with them and fellowshipping with them, with Paul as well. And it was just such a beautiful thing until some people from the church of Jerusalem, particularly James, the half-brother of Jesus, his church, came up to Antioch to kind of figure out what's going on up here, man. We hear things are exploding up here. And when they arrived, Peter's entire attitude changed from better to bitter. And he refused to eat with the Gentiles. He began to act all kosher and everything, where previously, with Paul and the Gentiles, he was acting as a believer, as someone who encouraged the Gentiles. Listen, I know you can't become, or you don't want to become Jews. You're Christians, and you've achieved all that you need to achieve. When people tell you you need to achieve something else, you tell them they're wrong. I believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. I've confessed such with my mouth that he has risen from the grave, and therefore I am saved. Galatians 2 says, now when Peter had come to Antioch, I withstood him to his face because he was to be blamed. Before certain men came from James, he would eat with the Gentiles. But when they came, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing those who were of the circumcision and the rest of the Jews who played the hypocrite with him, so that even Barnabas was carried away with their hypocrisy. But when I saw that they were not straightforward about the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter before them all, if you, being a Jew, live in the manner of Gentiles and not as Jews, why do you compel Gentiles to live as Jews? What is, as Paul would put it, the truth of the gospel? That Jesus performed and completed all on the cross. No wonder he said, it is finished. It is complete. It is tetelestai, paid in full. He did not say, hey, things are going to happen in the next few years where you're going to need to improve on what I did on the cross. No, he didn't say that. Paid in full, completed completely. To be an example, as Paul encouraged the readers in Philippi to follow his example and Epaphroditus' example and Timothy's example, you have to live a life that others would consider a godly example. I ask you this morning, do you live a life today that is a godly example to others? Would someone say, wow, it's been a joy to know you. You've answered so many questions in my life as a Christian, young Christian, or perhaps even as a non-Christian. You have compelled me to be saved like you because I see in your life that which is missing in my life. Not many people have that kind of testimony much anymore. Why is it? Because the Church of Jesus Christ no longer puts on the garment of praise. Puts on the holiness of Christ. It puts on a life that is chosen in many ways in this wicked world to be different from those that are in this world. And that's why Paul says in verse 18 of Philippians 3, for many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. Now, some would suggest that he's speaking specifically of the city of Philippi. You might think I'm suggesting it's only happening in the city of Santa Maria. But I would suggest to you that the Church of Jesus Christ has, in fact, in many ways, put down their garment of holiness and put back on the grave clothes of Lazarus. We've gone back to the things that we once thought were pleasurable in this world, that Jesus separated us from. Perhaps there is so much talk about a false grace these days that we are no longer compelled to confess our sins. There are doctrines that are invading the Christian church today that are running the gamut of not being even concerned about prayer. No wonder Paul said to the church of Thessalonica, pray without ceasing. Many walk. That means more than one or two. He is writing to the church of Philippi, and he's saying, there's a few. Maybe that means three. Maybe it'd be easy to pick out those three people within the church that refuse to put on the garment of praise. And I've told you often, perhaps Paul told them then, but he is now repeating, as it were, this warning, beginning back in verse 3, that there are Judaizers among you who are seeking to destroy the truth of the gospel. The truth of the gospel, which means you have been set free. You have been set free. And you are not to return to the grave clothes of Lazarus. You are not to return to the bounds and the captivity of your old life. Lazarus came forth, and he said, loosen him from his grave clothes. I have been set free from my grave clothes. I was set free many years ago, but there have been certainly more than a few temptations in my life to go back and put those stinky grave clothes on again. And you know what? The body of Christ must resist even more in these days than ever before the temptation to go back to the grave clothes of our life before Christ. Are you hearing? Are you listening to me? Say something so I know I can go on. And now I tell you, Paul says, I'm even weeping about it. Paul was a weeper. He was an emotional preacher. He had this sense about him that when he began to talk about things that truly pained him, he would begin to weep. Acts chapter 18 through 20 talk about Paul's encounter with the elders from Ephesus on the beach of Miletus when he passes through on his way back to Antioch to speak to the prophet Agabus. And as he stands on that beach with the elders that he's called from Ephesus, he begins to weep. And his weeping is bound in the understanding that he will never see them again. But that's not just what he was weeping about. He was weeping about the fact that prophetically he knew that wolves were about to attack that church. And the church of Ephesus no longer exists today. Not just because they left their first love in Revelation chapter 2 verses 1 through 8. But it was a church that exchanged the better for the bitter. I tell you, even now, weeping. Can you picture Paul sitting on the floor of a cave, as it were, in the refuse of other prisoners there, attempting by candlelight to write this as he is weeping? He is broken. His yearning desires to be with them, to encourage them deeper. But he says, all I can tell you is, follow the example that you found in me and in Timothy and in Epaphroditus, if you remember that example. Paul, in his letter to the Corinthians, wrote this in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 4. He said, for out of much affliction and anguish of heart I wrote to you, with many tears, not that you should be grieved, but that you should know the love which I have so abundantly for you. Every pastor should love his church. In fact, that church should be marked among the churches of the community as the best loved and the best fed sheep in town. Verse 19 of Philippians chapter 3. These many who are walking and that are enemies of the cross of Christ, their end is destruction, whose God is their belly and whose glory is in their shame, who set their mind on earthly things. What happens to a Christian when they begin to wander from the cross of Jesus Christ, from the empty grave? They begin to consider their BC days. And they may start to surround themselves with people that will tug them in directions that they know they should not wander. These are people whose minds are set on earthly things. Paul says in verse 20, our citizenship is in heaven. Our mind is set on heavenly things. The Holy Spirit knows that many more people today are walking with earthly intentions than there are those walking in heavenly intentions. I'm not talking about Christians alone. Certainly the number of those who do not believe in Christ far outnumber those who do. And we continue to pray for revival, don't we? We continue to pray for someone to carry the mantle of Billy Graham to the nations once again. We continue to pray that often it's been reported in deeply Muslim countries where people are having dreams of Jesus, having dreams of being washed in the blood of the Lamb, having dreams of being fully forgiven by the God of Israel, even as it was in the days of Nineveh. This is the same God who compels us to be better rather than bitter. Because you see, if you're bitter as a Christian, then you're not wooing anyone to Christ. Because they look at your life and they consider, well, their life is no different than mine. Why should I waste my time on Sunday mornings or waste my time, you know, with this or with that? The accoutrements of Christianity, one might say. Every choice we make is a choice to better or bitter, better or bitter. And by the way, I like you perhaps, I don't want to spend my time with bitter people. Do you? Oh, there are plenty of Christians who are never happy with anything. Plenty of Christians that are critical of everything. Plenty of Christians there are nothing is good enough. Plenty of Christians that are ready to turn your heart cold on a number of things. Ever sat in a restaurant, in a booth? Well, remember back when you could do that? Perhaps you heard Christians send back every plate that came to their table. This isn't right. That isn't right. Here's where it's wrong. That's where it's wrong. Then leave a tract on the table for a tip afterwards. Now that's the worst it probably could become, I think. But I've known plenty of Christians who are bitter about everything. They're just not happy people. I don't choose to spend my time with them. Because they certainly won't listen to an encouragement to be better rather than bitter. Because they're so used to the pendulum of bitterness that perhaps they've become like Paul, if he's the writer of the book of Hebrews, I believe that he is. When he wrote in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up in you trouble you, and by it be defiled. What happens when a thought of bitterness rises in your heart? It can gain roots down and deep into your life. And the deeper the roots, the more difficult it is to get rid of it. But the only way to get rid of a root of bitterness is through forgiveness. To take a proactive stance with forgiveness with those that you were formerly bitter with. To go out of your, really, you've gone out of your way to be bitter. Now go out of your way to be better. Go out of your way to forgive those people and do it audibly, do it with them, to their face. I forgive you. Please forgive me for my root of bitterness because I did not want to give you the grace that Christ gave me. I don't even want to forgive you the way Christ has forgiven me. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 31 says, let all bitterness and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. What is Paul saying? Ephesians, Church of Ephesus, stop being bitter. It's a choice. You have to make that choice. I can't make it for you. But boy, you'll hurt anyone's feelings when you respond to them in bitterness rather than betterness. Perhaps you're bitter this morning for unanswered prayers. Perhaps you're bitter this morning for a sickness that doesn't seem to be alleviated by the cross of Christ. Maybe you're bitter for heartbreak, for finances, for sadness, for depression. Maybe you're bitter over the possibility of what's going to happen next Tuesday. Believe me, friends, there's going to be a lot of people in America who are going to be bitter about the election results. Now, you have a choice to turn them to better by confounding them with the compassionate love of Christ. We have to do what the Lord has called us to do in due diligence. Christians, you must vote. You must vote. Vote pro-life. Always vote pro-life. Paul says to the Romans, "Now I urge you, brethren," Romans 16, verse 17, "note those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learned, and avoid them." You want to be infected with bitterness? Spend time around a bitter person. You want to be infected with bitterness? Spend time around those that choose betterness, not bitterness. For our citizenship, he says in verse 20, is in heaven. It's not here on earth. My passport may say United States of America, but my eternal passport says the living kingdom of God. And there's a day coming when I will walk through the pearly gate of the nation of Judah and into the very mansion of Christ, where he has promised me I will be, because he's prepared a place for me. And friends, I want to be prepared right now for the place he's prepared for me. I know you do as well. You wouldn't be here this morning unless you'd lost a bet from Aunt Madge or somebody like that. Our citizenship is in heaven. That's where we're leading our lives. He says, "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ," verse 21, "who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself." Transformed to be conformed. That's what I want right now. On this globe, right now, I want to be transformed so I can be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. I don't even need those anymore. Which may be good news to you, because I'm coming to a close. My heart really, dear friends, as your pastor that desperately loves you, it breaks my heart when people of our church begin to follow the Judaizers. It breaks my heart because I thought they were more mature than to do such things. But friends, we have a choice every single day, don't we? You might even say we have a choice every single minute, how we would respond. And Paul's grand encouragement for them is this: choose better, not bitter. Because bitterness will lead to a root of bitterness, and that's pretty tough to unroot and get rid of. And once again, bitterness can only be resolved, only be healed through forgiveness. Maybe you're bitter about something that's happened today or this past week. Or you know what? If you've watched 5 minutes of news on any channel, you're already bitter, right? Because you just can't understand how it could end up this way. But friends, we can make a difference. After all, Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world." Let's be salt. Let's be light. And let's promise today that irrespective of the results of the election, are you okay with this? Irrespective of the results of the election, we will not be bitter. We will be better. And we will continue to pray, and we will continue to seek the face of the living God for our nation, for this city. This is why it's so important for you to join me next Saturday at 10 a.m. City Hall, because we're going to be praying for God's compelling will upon this city. Hallelujah. Let's bow our heads, close our eyes. Father, I choose today to put an axe to the root of any bitterness in my heart. And I think about those who have struggled with illnesses for so long. Perhaps you've become bitter that God has not resolved that issue. Maybe it's a financial thing. Maybe it's an emotional thing. Maybe you just feel like all the things in life have gone against you, and you're bitter because you don't have what others have. And your envy and jealousy has led to just a bitterness with respect to your lot in life. And I say to you, there is a God in heaven who knows best. Father knows best. And he has a plan for your life. Turn to him. Turn to the Word of God. Turn in prayer. Turn in fasting. Turn in betterness to understand what Christ has for you today. And what he wants you to compel others through your lifestyle for tomorrow. You're going to be a better person. And people where you work, people where you live, people where you shop are going to look at you and go, wow, how can they be so better? How can they be so better when they were once so bitter? And you can turn to them and say, Jesus has made all the difference. And I've forgiven others as he has also forgiven me. Lord, do that today. Change us, transform us so that we can be conformed to the image of Christ, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.